All right. Whew. I think I figured it out. I have, I can scroll back up. I've more or less balanced the scales, so they're actually balanced, more or less. It's not perfectly balanced, so I'm hoping, gold, I'm hoping that our good buddy is going to go easy on us. Just hope that Bill go easy, you know, forgives us. Hope that Claude forgives us. I just... I don't know what to do otherwise, shit. Other than go and cry into a corner. Start reaching the jobless. Deal with the bosses. And here comes the date. One that's been rumored. Whispered about ever since. What am I doing wrong? I balanced the fucking fuck this. Fuck this. How? You can't even say that's a dictatorship. It's not more than 40%. Everything is fine. Claude, Bill, you fucking cunts. Why are you doing this to me? What did I... Is this because I'm not streaming right now? Just because I didn't decide to stream this? Is this like a lock? Am I unable to do content now? Okay. March 31st, 1967 is the worst day of my fucking life. Okay, here's what I'm gonna fucking do. Because I have a very narrow time frame, it seems, and I am going to be unable to get much done. We don't have time for another election. So, here's what I'm thinking we gotta do. If we want to see everything else in England, because I'm done with this shit. I am. I mean, I knew England was buggy, but I didn't know it was this bad. To the Spear. We read that. Embassies want embassies. Now that we are back, the world stage is over. Now that the Civil War is over, it's time to bring England back to the world stage. From South Africa to Scandinavia, we'll open an embassy in whatever nation will allow us. Some may be less than pleased with our prior affiliations, but opening relations is the first step to reconciliation. In addition, having good relations with the rest of the world will be a crucial step in getting England back on her feet. So, jobless. I think we read trade. The bosses, England rebuilt. We've read the all this. The Royal Army. We've read issue of conscription. We'll do that. Sterling. Among the many officers of your former general staff, David Sterling, remembered as a founder of short-lived SAS, has rather peculiar views on the future of the Royal Army. He spent years reflecting on our defeat in the war, and has come to a rather surprising conclusion. Our army failed to defeat the Germans not because it wasn't big enough, but because it was too large. Poor coordination, lack of training, and subpar logistics were the result of an excessive reliance on conscription and weighed heavily on our performance in the conflict. Just said initially, he produced pro-radical reforms. The new Royal Army should occur in Stirling. Focus on small, highly trained strike teams, each unit an expert in a single aspect of warfare. Claims that he specialized units in ABR equipment. These, I'll bypass that. Lieutenant Colonel David Stirling entered the PM's office without much fanfare, despite having been one to insist on the meeting. After a brief salute, he immediately got to the point. Prime Minister, it's come to my attention that the issue of the Royal Army is finally being addressed by the government. Is that true? Indeed it is, Lieutenant Colonel, came Jericho's cautious replies. Well, allow me to propose something. After a silent nod from Jellicoe, he went on, some of my peers believe that our defeat was not due to having enough men. These peers are morons. We lost because we had so many soldiers we didn't know where they were and how to direct them. What I propose is radical reform. That will make the Royal Army a professional fighting force. You do realize that waving radical reform in front of a general staff is the same as waving a red drape in front of a bull, don't you? The PM added with a worried grin. I won't deny the obvious, but I need to state something even more obvious. If we rebuild our army as it was before, it will be just as effective as it was before. We'll get the same end as we did before. What we need is a smaller force, unhindered by logistics, and armed and trained in such a way that they can overcome any resistance at the point we choose. What a complicated... War is a complicated business. Edge of Sword. SAS. Elite Force. Professional Army. A need for battleships. Battleships were still the undisputed queens of the endless waters, and the true patriots among us know this well. The Royal Navy boasted the largest concentration of dreadnoughts in the entire world, and it was only due to us being left alone in our fight against both the Germans and Japanese that we lost the seas. For our newfound glory, we shall restore our former glory. Funds will be allocated. There are some within the Naval Command who complain that with this money spent in a single battleship, we can commission an entire task force of a carrier and several screens, which they claim will be more powerful and effective. Their claims are flawed, of course, and the Royal Navy will be back from its ashes like the Egyptian Phoenix. Steel from America. In order to build a new battleship fleet, we need steel. Lots and lots of steel. Britain once boasted the largest metallurgic industry in the world. It's a result of the Industrial Revolution and our colonial empire. But 20 years of occupation and exploitation by the Germans have reduced much of our industry to ashes, and the Civil War finished the job. Thanks to our overseas allies, however, we can make up for some of the damages. American industrial conglomerates have offered to invest into new steel production facilities near our most prominent naval dockyards, probably sensing the chance to earn large state revenues from our military tenders. New state-of-the-art blast furnaces will be built with American money, and it will provide a much-needed boost to our steel production. Nice for you, father. Last week, PM Jellicoe visited his father's grave, as is a tradition every year. This time, however, he returned different. His face showed a new determination, a purpose he had seen that many had seen during the Civil War as he directed foreign support to our cause. We do not yet know what he had in mind, but it will surely be greatly beneficial to the UK as a whole. We just have to wait and see. St. Paul's Cathedral was almost empty this morning. The first rays of the sun were bathing the central nave, and only a few faithful were there, mostly praying to recently lost relatives. No one knows a single man entered the crypt, where some of the greatest heroes of the UK had been laid to rest. The figure walked quietly passing dozens of pillars until he found what he was seeking. John Jellicoe, 1st Earl Jellicoe, Admiral of the Fleet, Hero of Jutland, whatever. The plaque read, under a heavy cover of dust, with the only candle long since melted. Look at you. If Mother saw this, she would faint. The man chuckled before getting to work. He slowly cleaned the tombstone, removing the dust and shining the plaque. Once he was finished, he lit a new candle and put fresh flowers in place of long withered ones, whose stems and petals littered the ground. They are much better, don't you think? You used to tell me a man must always look presentable, even in the most difficult moments, father. George Jellicoe kneeled before the tombstone, affectionately touching the photo of his stern-looking admiral. You know, it's so difficult sometimes. If I could lead the party half as well as you led the fleet, he sighed. Still, I know my duty, and I won't give up. I promise I'll make you proud. One day the Royal Navy will be as it was when you were alive, or better, he said. Determination haunted his eyes. Please, Father, give me your blessing, that I might succeed in what I must do. The group remained silent, but he already received the answer he had come for. The last notch is Father's grave. He got up and left. Your dream is mine now. So it looks like we have to finish building the Jericho. Is there a little thing for that? Yeah, we have a year to do it. So, let's create some more jobs in the north. Even before the Civil War, the northern part of England struggled due to cuts in government funding and projects. No government member wanted to associate with such a rebellious region, so employment and growth lagged behind the south. If we finally not improve the situation, now infrastructure and housing are a significant problem. Now that the Civil War is over, and we face less pressure towards from Germany, we can begin to push more funding towards these left-behind areas and help them to once again be the industrial heart of England. What we need to do, foreign jobs. We still have enormous trade dependency on the U.S. and Russia reopen. And, some of our members have grown uncomfortable with the number of jobs being shipped overseas to these nations. Furthermore, there are many Americans here in England that say that many say are taking away jobs from the hardworking English men and women. The more liberal elements of our party maintain that such trade is necessary and that our economic ties with the Americans further our national security interests. We must find a way to defuse tensions on both sides regarding this vital economic issue before the complaints boil over. Recently, Parliament has been embroiled in the debate on whether or not the new government should prioritize the growth of foreign or domestic jobs. Opinions on which direction to take has split the NDL down factional lines. Surprisingly, both Mr. Williams and MP Powell both agree on prioritizing domestic job growth, and their respective factions are likely to follow along with them. Both acknowledge that the effects of this will not be seen for some time. However, both argue that this would ensure England's economic independence and strength in the long run. Foreign Minister Stavas argues that the short-term growth found by bringing jobs is essential to England's economic recovery. Even much of that growth will be tied to foreign interests. Both left and right factions accuse Stavas of selling out to the OFN, but have rallied together to oppose the notion they have only enough combined votes to stall a vote. Deputy Minister Eccles and a small pro-status quo faction are currently undecided and could be the deciding vote. As usual, it falls to you, Earl, to unite the party. Perhaps some words to Parliament could sway one way or the other. England should always place her own needs over the profits of others. Let's focus on the OFN. The OFN is our greatest ally. Just as it helps us militarily, they can help us economically. We shall expand our trade operations on the OFN member nations, especially the U.S., and in doing so, we shall improve our own economy. Expansion into free Europe. While Spain and France may not be the most democratic nations, they are somewhat free from the grip of the German Reich. Along these nations, we can also expand trade into Scandinavia and the Balkans. We can improve our economy and increase our influence in Europe at the same time. Then trade agreements with Italy. Italy's government is vastly different to ours, but that isn't important now. Regardless of their ideology, Italy hasn't had good relations with Germany for almost two decades now, making them a bulwark against German expansion. If we sign some trade agreements with the Italian government, we might be able to sway them closer to our side. And then we're into a new phase. Now that our immediate economic issues have been dealt with, we can move on to social matters. The social issues of a country must be addressed from taxation to education. We owe the English people, whether they vote us or not, for a better future, for a better England. Jellicoe put down the report. He groggily rubbed his eyes and started to head out for the night. He had been working overtime for the last several weeks, arguing with his advisor in Parliament to pass emergency bills to stabilize the government. Projections showed that the perilous freefall that they had been in, at least for now, stabilized. He saluted the guard as he drove away. Jellicoe drove down a fresh street and smelled the calm evening air. The smell of freshly baked bread. Saw a happy family moving boxes from a car. Although there was still much to do for the economy, Jellicoe couldn't help but feel some satisfaction. The job wasn't done, far from it. Stavas had riled up a liberal wing to shift the country's focus to social reforms, notably decriminalizing homosexuality. Already patriots have come out strongly in opposition, although Powell seems reluctant to follow, along with more hateful rhetoric coming from his faction. However, if his party didn't act decisively, the socialists would definitely use this to gain more support. Yes, the next weeks and months of Jellicoe's prime membership would be spent trying to wrangle the Bardia Act one way or the other to address the social issues of England. But that was tomorrow's problem. Jellicoe felt he deserved at least one good night's sleep. The soul of England is at risk. And then I guess the Air Force, fuck it. Once the undisputed rule of the skies, the Royal Air Force is but a shadow of its former glory, the harsh conditions imposed by the treaty, and 20 years of neglect and economic downturn have transformed our Air Force into a comatose patient. Even now, all we have is some birds left by the collaborators and whatever our friends in Canada, the U.S. could spare for us. For to reestablish a fully functional Air Force, we have to rebuild everything from scratch. As part of his goodwill tour of the most prominent military installations around London, Powell visited RAF Norfolk. Even though he would have preferred being spared the humiliation, one of the largest airstrips in all of England, from which the first BE-2 left to bomb German positions in 1914, it was now a perfect representation of the state of the RAF. Barren. The base was eerily empty, with only a skeleton maintenance crew to keep the landing strip free of grass. The scant few airplanes in service of the Collaborator Air Force had mostly been shot down by partisan AA batteries or fled the country with their German pilots. Now almost nothing remained save the spirit of the first English aviators. Powell visited the empty hangars, the majority of which were entirely abandoned. The head of the maintenance crew, the highest officer left in the base, is visibly distraught by what he is forced to show the minister, but Powell can't blame him for what is the fault of 2 decades of corruption and decadence. When the visit ends, there are no inspirational speeches or photo opportunities, only an embarrassed handshake between the two, the promise on the minister's part that things are going to change, for the better this time. Shit, what else? Jets are the feature, I think. Jet airplanes are the feature of air combat. Far faster than any prop plane, they can climb higher than anything in the sky. During the occupation, the Royal Air Force was barred from having anything resembling the newest German models, which means we'll have to start from the basics. We should immediately establish a research group to analyze the jet engine designs and teach our best engineers how to build and maintain them. It will be difficult, and we'll need the help of our allies, but there is much to gain. American jet models. Let's go, do it. For our lack of experience on jet airplanes, we have no idea what kind of airframe would best suit such a powerful engine. With the looming risk of producing flying caskets for our test pilots, we'll need to rely on our American allies once more to avoid unnecessary problems. By building some of the outdated designs and having our research team study them, we'll soon be able to fully understand the most important concepts of jet engine flight, and then apply them to our own domestically produced airplanes. Let's improve those engines. Now that we understand the basic functioning of a jet engine, and we already have a small jet force, we can slowly start improving our designs. Modern advancements in the field allow our technicians to tweak engines and airframes and allow for greater speed without greater risk. Of course, we'll need some help from our friends in the Alliance to fully understand the scope of our research, but we'll make sweeping advances in a short time, allowing us to fill the gap between us in modern air combat. And then, fuck, I don't know. Let's do better engines. The General Staff has reviewed Harris' proposal and found it extremely promising. He shall receive all the funding he needs, as long as he also focuses his attention on new improved engines for our bombers. Not accurate, but whatever. With war assuming more and more of a transcontinental value, it is of the utmost importance that our long-range aircraft are able to cross seas and oceans if necessary. Our enemies will fear us from Germania to Tokyo. And then the British Air Force. While erstwhile allies have offered to help us rebuild our air force, we don't need their help. We battled the German Stukas in the skies of London before the Americans ever thought about helping us, and we'll do so again if a need arises. We can't expect the others to save us, and for that reason, we can ultimately count only on ourselves. The RAF will be a shining example of British ingenuity and combat skills. If we fail, it will be our own fault, but if we succeed, it will be our triumph and ours alone. We've done it. We've done all the focuses we can. Well, hold on. Allow Diplo. That that. While we're here, I might as well get working on reunification, because apparently we're not going to have the time to, because, you know. The game is deciding to suck. The Kingdom of England and Wales has defeated the state of Wales in a war. War is hell. Now that's what I'm talking about. Let's speak with the Patriots. I'm sure they love that shit, right? Celebrations in London tonight as the Welsh government has sued for peace. The Anglo-Welsh Wars were over and ended exactly the way everyone seemed to expect. Despite brave Welsh resistance, England was strong enough to quickly break through the Welsh lines and enter Cardiff. England intends to integrate Wales as another part of itself. However, there's still a large amount of Welsh resistance and is heavily armed. Experts believe Wales is going to be hard to occupy for England, especially in the near future, but we're one step closer. Now some time has passed since unification was finally realized, so facts have started to... Do we have a core on this? Just a colony. Have started to be felt by the people of Wales. Initially, nothing much changed. The shops stayed open, and they spoke the same language as before. Many even wondered what all the fuss had been about. How this would change. English goods would fill the shelves of Welsh stores. Joblessness began increasingly common, and less people sell to, but stores shut down. An influx of English arriving in the country would also make the Welsh language worthless, wiping out much of the local country with it. A way of life was passing away in front of them. One they had never thought they would miss, and there was nothing they could do to stop them fading away. Well, they're stuck with us now. Stilla! Still nothing. So we have about... We have a couple days, so... While we still got time... Let's kick these fucking Scots back. We'll take your lives and your freedom, motherfuckers. Fucking bastards. Basic jet tactical bombers. Light aircraft, that's what we want to look at. Would be a real shame if a mutiny happened, if you know what I mean. Tag, what was it? Skull? Thanks for playing. Thank you. I'm not done yet, but thank you. Tag. Bloody shame that. I blame Himmler. Watch. We do all this and it turns out, we don't get overthrown. Now that would just be funny. Of course it didn't fucking happen. You know what? We're doing a speed run of all this shit. Fuck it. I wish I could post it on the Discord. Nothing much. I don't know what I'm doing wrong. If someone could tell me in the comments, I'd appreciate it. Okay. Focus.autocomplete. Okay. Ready? All right. There we go. Alright, we gotta wait for that. Da-da-da. So England's at stake. So is my sanity. You don't see me fucking saying anything? Okay. Oh, Diplo. See a Scotland. See a Wales. I'm guessing it's going to be too late for, yeah, there goes Wales. Yada yada, they're stuck with us now, whether they like it or not. And not only the Scots, they probably don't. But they should have thought of that before the game hurt my feelings and I got tired of its shit. Alright, it's not their fault, but... Okay, we'll take Perth. We're gonna take Glasgow soon enough. I doubt it's gonna take much more than that. I imagine with this, we overran those guys. How much longer do they have? They still are hanging in there. Props to them, I guess. Try to take Dundee. I'm surprised that fucking city's worth anything, but, you know. Alright. Tag Skull. Yeah. Tag Ing. Tagging. Going to Inverness. And we'll have to take what... I don't want to get rid of this guy, because that would just be too easy. But I have to imagine... After that, we're done, right? Leaving Dundee a heaping pile of rubble. And disappointment and depression. So modern Dundee, basically. I've taken Aberdeen. All right, loves. Right, bloody did it. Those Patriots, Liberals. Now here's a question. What happens if you Liberals have more power? Things are slowly becoming better in Scotland. The air is less foggy. The skies are a bit brighter. The people aren't as angry as they used to be. It seems the hatred and anger towards the English and Scottish and in Scotland has gotten better. Resentment will always be there, it seems, but right now it isn't manifesting itself as it used to. Government is slowly getting a grip on the situation, and hopefully soon it'll only be a dark memory. May there be peace in the north. In the aftermath of a campaign many are calling reminiscent of a Western Front of the First World War, England has succeeded in defeating Scottish armies, and is in full control of a nation. English flags fly over every part of the nation, and Scotland's government has been captured. Despite the organized surrender of the Scottish forces, many smaller units are still in action fighting guerrilla warfare against the occupying English. Despite this, England now has crushed any threat to its ambitions to restore the United Kingdom or territory or of a similar geographical control. Now London is almost certain to declare themselves the rightful successor to the British Empire and demand the same respect, a union once again. Time to rule the waves. Britain shall never, never, never be slaves. Britannia,
Britannia rule the waves. Britons never, never shall be slaves.
And you know what? We had to cheat our way there, but I'm glad. We did it, guys. We right well bloody did it. Sort of. I mean, it wasn't legitimately. But the game didn't want us to do it legitimately. So, you know. That's what you gotta do. So what I think about the UK run, it was fun until the worst day of my life, March 31st, 1967, happens. I'm gonna... I'll save real quick just to see if it still happens. What about liberalism? See, now the liberals have more power. I wonder if anything... Is it gonna happen? Are you cunts gonna do something? Well, you know what? Even if they do, worst case scenario, yep. You know what? This is fucking horseshit. This event. They don't fucking warn you it's gonna happen. They tell you if one of these organizations gain more than however many much power, yeah, okay, there'll be defections. The party might fall apart. But they don't tell you if there's enough moderate power, they're gonna look at you like a dictator and overthrow you. And even when you figure that out, they still fuck you. I guess real quick. Just to see the rest of the content. I wonder if there's an event, if he take over, Ulster and the, Irish. So that would be interesting. T to bug. Annex. Ulz. We'll just leave that for now, and if that doesn't work, we'll go ahead and, take over the rest. Those Welsh cunts are gone. And real quick, focus dot no checks. Why not? The old alliance. The U.S. and England have always had to maintain a special relationship. We've done our best to maintain peace and democracy in the old and new world for past centuries. And despite our defeat against the Reich nearly 20 years ago, there remains a bond between our two nations. Through two world wars, the two greatest English-speaking nations of the world have been tried and tested like no other Grand Alliance. It's only natural now that in our hour of need, we look to the U.S. once more as a partner and friend. Surely we can restore the good old nature and the good old humor of an alliance not yet forgotten. Alright, I forgot. I gotta focus. Get that done. If Australia and New Zealand officially broke off from the Empire, their ties to the OFN and our shared history and language keep us close in spirit, if not in geography. We should reach out to these former Commonwealth and current OFN members to help us rebuild our country and reestablish diplomatic ties with the rest of the world. Let's do it. Rescind our claims. Oh, no. As much as it might sting, we're no longer an empire on which the sun never sets. We must think more practically about our position in the world. That means making small sacrifices for a larger gain. The prestige of some small islands in the middle of the ocean is not worth the support of potential allies in the OFN. Renouncing our claims to these islands will present us as a team player in a potential alliance and as a country.
focused on more democratic ideals than regaining a lost empire.
That's gonna sting.
Well, they said they will return. Many Britons are understandably bitter about the withdrawal of American troops during the Second World War. However, with this withdrawal came a promise that one day freedom would return to England.
Now that it has, we expect the Americans to keep it here.
Open air bases for RAF. While our own RAF continues to grow, we require the assistance of our allies to ensure that the skies over England are friendly for the time being, allowing our offensive nations, including the United States, to base advanced fighters and bombers. Here will buy us time to develop our own forces and ensure that we can ward off any attempts by the Germans to violate our airspace. Looks good for me. OFN bases. Our army is not in any state to fight off counterattack by the Germans should it come to that. We need more men, more equipment, and more time to organize our troops. The OFN can provide all three if we give them the rights to station bases at strategic locations in England. All this technically has violated our sovereignty, everything has its cost, and a few well-armed Yanks on English soil is worth never having to endure such calamities as we have. And ties with Canada. Through all the hardships, I need a sip of water. My throat is coarse. And no wonder I've had to read however much, pretty much half of the focus tree in about 40 minutes, because I know I'm not going to be able to get to it if I can't. When Tobruk and the Suez Canal were lost, she remained loyal. When Britain itself was invaded, she remained loyal. Through decades of oppression and hardship, she remained loyal. It's time to recognize the contributions of Canada to our victory, to give our humble thanks to our most steadfast supporters in whatever ways we can. We got the royal visit. As part of our Thanksgivings, the Queen shall return to Canada, her second home, to pay homage to the support they have given us. Other members of the royal family shall accompany her through the country and celebrate the return of freedom to England, the dawn of a new future few would have dreamed possible just 10 years ago. The cannons boomed, the cameras snapped, and the crowd cheered on the Ottawa tarmac as the royal family descended from the aircraft. They got to the bottom of the stairs and were greeted by the Prime Minister of Canada and the Governor General, along with various other notables. As we walked to the car, the PM asked Queen, "How are you feeling today, Your Majesty?"
"Excited, to be quite honest," said the Queen. "It's peculiar. When I was in exile here, I found myself eager to get back to London by any method possible. I was overjoyed when everything went how we hoped, but after a few months in London, I began to wish to see Canada again." Philip agreed.
"Regardless, a royal visit by the Queen of England is quite an honor for us in Canada."
"I suppose it is, though I do say you must expect these royal visits to be far more regular from now on. The airplane has really lowered the barrier of travel time and expense for trips like these.
You may feel free to visit the same nation that hosted you for so many years, Your Majesty. Who says you can't go home again? With the free world. After gaining the favor of the OFN, we are now firmly cemented as one of the free nations of the world. We've built our relation with the former Commonwealth members and reaffirmed the old alliance with the United States. Uncle Sam and Britannia are arm in arm once more, and the light of democracy shall never fail on our island again, except for Claude and fucking Bill fucking up things. And then finally, a democratic England. Never before in our history has England been so democratic, with the voting franchise extended to those from all walks of life, of all colors and creeds. So through our continuing reforms that we have transformed our damp little island nation into a beacon of freedom and opportunity. We have done this after civil war, after invasion, after a totalitarian power crushed our spirit. England is free in more ways than one. And you know what? I'm happy with that. I really am. Let's open that up. Oh, we got a couple places that don't have don't have support popping up, which is kind of weird, but, you know, what are you going to do? And finally, We technically haven't finished it, but fuck it. Let's finish it. Today is a momentous day for the United Kingdom and the restored Royal Navy. After more than a year of tireless work in our most advanced dive docks, the HMS Jellicoe is ready to be launched. The Queen herself will bless the ship, and the event will be broadcasted nationwide, perhaps even worldwide. Mr. Worldwide, this marvel of modern engineering will rival the greatest ships built in history, surpassing the Bismarck and even capable of challenging the Yamato. The HMS Jellicoe will serve as our new flagship from today onwards, until the day Jupiter himself strikes its hull with the might of his thunder. Rule Britannia, Britannia, rule the waves. My singing voice is worse than it usually is. With all the damn speaking. Britain shall never, never, never shall... Wait. I'll do it again. Rule Britannia, Britannia, rule the waves. Got that voice crack. Britons never, never, never shall be slaves. Portsmouth had seen many fateful events during its long life as the main military dockyard in the UK. Nelson returned there from Trafalgar and welcomed sailed from its docks to face Napoleon. But in more recent times, it had been the stage of some of the greatest humiliations in the long history of the Empire. The return of the fugitives from Dunkirk, the heavy German bombings, and as a last insult, the triumphal return of King Edward VIII after the final surrender of the Commonwealth. Today's ceremony is a happy one, however. Hopefully the first of many to come. In the presence of the Queen herself, the entire government, and a crowd of more than 50,000 have come to see the launch of a new flagship of the Royal Navy, the HMS Jellicoe, named after the Prime Minister's father, the Admiral who led the Grand Fleet against the German Hochseeflotte at the Battle of Jutland, whatever. The HMS Jellicoe is a sight to behold, with a length overall of 256 meters. She's longer than the Bismarck, a point of honor for the shipbuilders, just shy of equaling the Yamato. Thanks to 15 inches of steel armor and an armament of 3 triple 40-centimeter guns, 8 double 15-centimeter guns, dozens of smaller emplacements for both aircraft and anti-ship duty, anti-ship missiles, and anti-submarine mortars, this battleship excels in both offense and defense. All the cameras record the moment where the Queen, exceptional sponsor of a ship, perfectly aims the bottle and delivers a flawless inauguration to deafening applause. When the Prime Minister takes the podium for final speech, he's almost in tears from joy. His words are few and cracked by emotion, but everyone catches the final phrase and cheers even louder. The line more... I gotta get this right. So the last line we're reading for this. The line rose again, roars of... fuck. It's almost 2:30 a.m. I've had a deal with a bunch of grads. The line roars again, Father. Good enough. And I think that's it. Yeah. So, let me know. You know what? Let's... Annex Ireland. Now that's nice. I like that. Are we not gonna get the last stripe? Nah, fuck it. It doesn't matter. What matters is, we did it. It about as legitimately as we really could. Again, to kind of go back to, what I was kind of talking about before, this was a fun game, don't get me wrong, it's just the end kind of fucked things up. I relaunched this game from the last save, which, it was from, before the patch, so the patch might have fucked with things a bit, but I've heard a lot of people having this issue, so I don't know, one way or the other. If it's still in the game, Debs, please fix it, because it's annoying.
and took a lot of wind out of me, and I was having fun with it. But I still had fun at the end, I think, but it took a lot of fun out of it, unfortunately. But, for now, what else can I say? But we did it. We really did. Me personally,
I did more or less everything I wanted to do. We reformed the United Kingdom. Again, we had to do some console shit to kind of enable it. But
we did it before the worst day in British history. Worse than the capitulation to the Germans. Worse than the inauguration of Eddie VIII. Worse than all of that. March 31st, 1967, the day where Alexander and Auchinleck decided to be cunts and ruin my game, which was going great, too. I mean, really, they had to mess it up, didn't they? And they managed to make Sterling, of all of them, look like the better guy, which should be disgraceful. So, if I could say something, what else can I say? I don't know when this is going up. Germany might already be recording and uploading by the time this is done. If not, Germany's next. If it is, probably the USA afterwards. I'm going to hold off on that. Maybe a little bit. Maybe until the OFN update that adds Canada and Mexico's trees. I'm not sure yet. But what I do know is, sure, let me see if I can tag USA. Let's see if there's something on their end that lets me join the OFN officially. Let's see, a lot of Republicans, a few Democrats, a lot of far-right NPPs. All right. There's nothing. There's literally nothing. But, yeah. Fun game, it just kind of crashed and burned at the end there. Which, I mean, I know there were some issues with, England and all that. That's why they had to delay it for the release. I just kind of, I don't know. I'm a little salty. I'm a little upset that it had to end like this. But, you know, I will say one thing. I don't care if he is somehow a dictator, even though he's balanced the scales pretty perfectly up until now, but whatever. George Jellicoe will go down as one of the greatest PMs in British history. He brought democracy back. He helped unify England into Britain like it properly should be. And, he knew how to compromise. He knew to never give up. And he wasn't afraid to fight for what he wanted to do. Even if that, flew in the face of, old Claude and Bill. who, acting pretty fascist-y for people who claim to be against fascism, but, you know, that's besides it, the point. My voice is coarse. I have a book. I gotta finish Edward Snowden's book and turn it in by the end of the day, or else I'm gonna get, you know, overdue charge or something. I don't know exactly. I don't know. All I do know is that, I'm thankful for you guys for watching this, so thank you again, as always, for watching. If you like this video, leave a like. If not, feel free to dislike. If you want to see more of this stuff in the future, I have uploads going up every weekday, as well as every Saturday, so if you want to check that out, do it. If you want to chat, play games, anything of sort, check out my Patreon. And if you want to send a few bucks my way financially, sorry, I'm messing up on my intro. I'm tired. Stayed up too long trying to rectify this, and I was thinking if I get it right, I'll go back to bed and I'll continue it. But I didn't get it right, and I'm not gonna restart this shit, and I'm too tired to do much at this point. So we're ending it now. Thanks as always for watching. Check out my Patreon, my Discord, my Twitch, leave comments, subscribe, notification bell, all that good stuff. Thanks for watching as always. I said that 3 times already, but I do mean it. Thank you guys, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.